That was great. That was fun to watch.
Yeah, it's interesting for me because I'm watching things behind the scenes as well as what ended up.
I was wondering who did all the wardrobes. Like the best wardrobe ever in the movie.
Yeah, you know, it was a woman named Allison Lances, but she got a lot of the stuff from, oh, I'm trying to think of what that woman, she became the costume designer on Sex in the City, but she used to have a store. Patricia Fields. A lot of this stuff came from Patricia Fields' store when it was on 8th Street, or St. Paul's.
Well, the energy of the film captures that time in New York, like sort of the punk, post-punk era. Can you talk about what that scene was like for you at that time? And have a lot of, you know, get a sense of how this film came out of that.
Yeah, well, I had gone to film school. Can everyone hear me? I had gone to film school at NYU. And at the time, NYU, the grad school was located on 7th Street and 2nd Avenue, which was pretty funky at the time. And also, this was, I was there during the late 70s when New York was going through a bankruptcy crisis. So the whole city was a little bit, you know, falling apart and crumbling. But that was a great time to be young and artistic in New York because you could afford a lot of, young people could still afford to live in Manhattan. And also, the city had great texture because especially downtown, because there were a lot of bands that were flypapering, you know, all over downtown. So it was like an art gallery. The streets really just had that layered graffiti look. And so actually, we did do some art direction. The interiors were art directed, but a lot of the streets and the exterior shots, that's just what it looked like. We just selected the right streets.
There wasn't much of an independent feature film movement at the time. Like a lot of the low budget films at that area were like Super 8 movies, and you know, this was before Spike Lee or Jim Jarmusch did features. So can you talk about like what it was to like decide and do feature film?
Yeah, well, coming out of NYU film school, I liked narrative filmmaking, so I was interested in storytelling. Actually, it was around the same time as Jim Jarmusch because we were he was at film school the same time I was. And if you look at his films, they also have more of a narrative tone than some of the other stuff that was being made. But really, in some ways, I was influenced more by, you know, when I was in film school, I loved the French New Wave cinema of the 60s. So I loved that feeling of shooting out in the streets, telling kind of authentic feeling movies that had interesting characters, and where you use the street life and the energy to be a big part of the story.
So what was it like, you know, putting the production together? You talked about stretching it out over, you know, over a year, shooting whenever you scrape a little bit of money together.
Yeah, it was done in drips and drabs, not intentionally, but actually as a result of an accident. We started filming in 1980, and we filmed for a week, and the leading lady, Susan Berman, during a rehearsal while we were shooting, fell off the fire escape and broke her leg. And it was disastrous at the time because, you know, it was a pretty serious accident, and she was in a cast for about 3 months, longer actually, and I thought I was never going to be able to finish the film. But what was interesting was that, so we filmed for a week and I stopped because of the accident. But during that hiatus, I was able to look at what was working, what wasn't working, and also to recast the movie, because in the original movie, the first week, Richard Hell wasn't in the film. And the actor that was a kind of different type. He was more of a kind of art gallery owner. He wasn't a rock and roller. And so being able to see what was working and seeing that the grittier stuff was working better than some of the other stuff we had shot, I could then go back and rework on the script. And around that time, I brought in a collaborator, somebody who was literally had just graduated from Columbia Film School. And it was a writer named Ron Neiswander who went on to write the actually went get nominated for an Academy Award for Philadelphia. He's one of the writers of Ray Donovan and lots of other movies. And he really helped me kind of hone what was working and what wasn't.
And, yeah, and how did the storyline come about? Was it really starting with this character with Ren and sort of doing a portrait?
It was really all about the character, and in some ways, it was inspired by kinds of young women I had seen downtown. It's not at all autobiographical, but there were aspects of it. You know, the idea of this girl from the suburbs, from New Jersey. For me, New Jersey is a metaphor for Philadelphia, where I came from. A girl who comes from someplace else and wants to go to the city to try to be a part of whatever that energy was that she felt was lacking, you know, where she came from. But it was also inspired by some kinds of actresses that I had really liked. Some of the actresses like, Anna Karenina?
Anna Karenina.
Yeah, from the Godard movies, but also an actress that I liked a lot named Julieta Messina, who was in a Fellini movie called, not many Fellini movies, but Nice of Cabiria. And I'd seen that movie, and there was just something about that kind of tenacious, but this girl who wants so much and keeps getting kind of knocked down, but picks herself back up. And that reminded me a lot of the character.
Did you feel that this was something that was missing in American film, like a woman agonist like that?
I wasn't feeling like, yeah. Actually, yeah. But really where it was coming from was being a female filmmaker at a time that there weren't that many of them, and feeling like there were so many stories about male protagonists that I enjoyed, like Midnight Cowboy. Those kinds of stories, but I'd never seen a kind of female, a scrappy female protagonist, and since I was a film director, I felt, it wasn't something I felt I should do, it was something I had to do, because I like those characters.
Where did you find the lead actress, and then what's happened with her?
She was in an off Broadway play, and a friend of mine had seen her, and we had auditioned some young actresses, and no one had that right edge. And then my friend said, "Why don't you come meet this woman?" And she had never acted in a movie before. I saw her, and it was just something about her that I loved. And
what was it like getting the film out there? This was before the Sundance Film Festival, before there was a Queens World Film Festival.
Yes.
what was it like? Because you had this, independent film really was independent at that time.
It really was because, again, it was before the internet, so I didn't even know about film festivals, but I had heard about the Cannes Film Festival, and so I literally found out the address. I don't know how, maybe it was in my book. I found out the address, and I sent a postcard to the admissions committee at the Cannes Film Festival, and kind of forgot about it. And then I got a call a couple weeks later saying, they were in New York, could I drop the film off at a screening room? I did. And I had just gotten the film out of the lab, and I saw it and accepted it into the festival. It happened pretty quickly. And I was totally naive about what it all meant, but there was something kind of wonderful about being so naive.
And I'm assuming that's when Zeke and Susan came out as a result of the response.
Well, what happened was it was accepted to Cannes, and then it started to get some attention, and got picked up by New Line Cinema at the time. And I got an agent, and weirdly enough, there were so few women making movies, and after this, I knew I had to be really kind of smart about the next movie I did, especially if it was going to be a bigger budget movie or a studio movie, because I had heard of some female independent filmmakers who had done an interesting low-budget movie, went on to do their first studio movie, and it didn't work out because there were so many people looking over their shoulder, or the dynamics were so different. So I spent about 2 years reading a lot of bad scripts about cheerleaders and high school students, and it just wasn't what I wanted to do. And then finally, literally, my agent just submitted the script to me called Desperately Seeking Susan. It had my name in it. And but what it also had, there are parts of the movie that reminded me of this. You know, it was a mix of two different worlds, the suburban world of Roseanne Arquette character and the kind of funky downtown world of the Madonna character. So I thought I could kind of relate to both those worlds. So it felt like the right fit.
I want to take some audience questions, but I just want to ask you one thing about the filmmaking. Like the, I talked about the energy in the film. Talk a bit about like what you were trying to do with how you shot the film. I mean, it has a really bold visual style.
Well, some of the energy just comes from it being such a low budget film, not having much lighting, but trying to use that rough aesthetic in a positive way, rather than trying to be slick and not succeeding. I thought it was better to kind of embrace the low budgetness of it as part of the energy and as part of the style of the movie, and use it as an advantage, not a disadvantage.
Okay.
A little caveat, funny little thing. In the back of the van, in the very last scene, we'll see a male prostitute. That was the screen debut of Chris Noth, who went on to be
really?
Mr. Big. Yeah. That's in the back of the van. Yeah.
Right. And did you direct the first episode of Sex and the City? Go ahead, right there. Advice for young females.
More of them, and they should just keep making films. I mean, that's the thing about filmmaking. I mean, right now, it's such a different time, and the technology is more accessible. It's easier to get a hold of, you know, equipment. It's easier to get your films out there because of the internet, but it really is all about telling stories, you know? So I think, you know, female directors, but all directors, should have a story that they want to tell, and it doesn't matter, you know, just make sure that you, as I said, sort of embrace your turn disadvantages into advantages if you can. But it's all about the story and the characters. In the sense that if you were involved in the arts, if you were a filmmaker, you knew people who were in bands, you knew artists like Lee Kionas, the graffiti artist who painted the van. So everyone was very open and eager to say, oh, I have this friend so-and-so. And I forget whether it was Richard Ho or somebody else who said, well, my friend Cookie, you know, would love to be in the film, and so he asked you to be a part of it. And I also love you know, bad B movies, so that's a main role.
Right there in the front.
You mentioned the Fellini influence. I was struck by the fact that Ren always seemed to have this comeback, like when she immediately turns on the guy who rejects her, you know, it's like, I could play better by this, or, you know, I've got a million and one places to go. And finally, with the driver, you expect her to say that, or at least have something, and you just stop there. And Kabira, for instance, where we see her smiling throughout this thing here, what do you think her future is?
Well, I think she's a survivor. She was, you know, I'm not sure where she, well, at the end she might have been going back to New Jersey. That happened to be near the bridge that would cross over to New Jersey. But I think, I wanted to leave it ambiguous, but I believe she is a survivor. So I didn't want it to be totally sad.
I hope.
intentionally did not want to deal with drugs, nor did I, you know, there's sexual material in there, but it's not gritty. It's sort of comedic, a lot of the way that sex is handled. But I think I didn't want the film to be really depressing, and maybe that's also, you know, there was something tonally that I wanted to embrace the grittiness but make it bittersweet. And a lot of the films that I liked, for example, like the Fellini movies, have that, the earlier ones, have that tone where it's just not so depressing. And I also liked adding little moments of humor, whether it's weird visual humor or whether it is just, you know, some weird funny line of dialogue. But that was a sense just to kind of keep it a little buoyant.
Go ahead.
Just, you know, and somehow involved in the arts, music, especially that kind of rock music, was such a big part of it. And not really just because of the music, but because of the kind of aesthetic and the, you know, the graphics, the visuals, the clothes, you know, it was all kind of one piece. Also, there was this feeling like anyone, even if you didn't really have to be a musician to be in a band, and you didn't really have to, you know how to paint to be an artist. And that's a little bit of the attitude that the character of Red has. You know, she kind of wants to be famous, but she's not, doesn't have a particular skill. Sort of like today, right?
Right, yes.
Part of New York? What inspired me to shoot?
Today.
Today. Oh, wait.
Yeah, that's fishing for that.
No, yeah. I mean, Manhattan downtown isn't this at all. You know, maybe, I can't answer that. I'm sorry, I'd love to. I don't know. I don't know.
Right down here.
Of what was going on. That was the inspiration. I also want to give credit, I think, you know, when I watched again now, not having seen it for many years, the music also gives it a kind of energy. And I have to thank, it was an up-and-coming director at that time who, you know, had made two feature films, and I hadn't made any at this point, but was very helpful to young filmmakers, and that was Jonathan Demme. It was actually Jonathan Demme that put me in touch with the Feelies, who did the music. And I couldn't afford a composer. So really what I did was they had come out with their first album, or recorded their first album. And I literally just took it and just cut pieces of it together and put it in the soundtrack. So nothing was actually composed for the movie. It was all just collaged and assembled.
What were the shows of the film like in New York? I think it played at the Waverly.
It did play at the Waverly, and you know, again, because it was
the ISC Center.
You know, independent cinema, there weren't that, because it was so much more maybe expensive, not expensive, but you know, filming on celluloid required certain craft, the skills that today are different because you can make a movie on your iPhone. So there were less independent films being made. And as a result of that, I think the film did get a lot of attention because it was the beginning of the independent film movement. And also it's when independent film meant independent film. It meant you had no money and you were doing it. It didn't mean the Weinstein.
No, New Line Cinema at the time was releasing the John Waters movies, not
but they didn't finance it, so it was just, you know, they picked it up. But independent film was very narrow, a much more narrow definition. Well, first of all, Soho was very different, and that was Green Street, probably Green and like Spring of Prince, you know. I was doing this in a very naive way. I didn't know what you needed to do to make a movie on the streets of New York. And that was kind of an advantage. I didn't know you needed permits. You know, where the van is parked, literally, we just drove around and found this deserted lot.
We never stopped. You didn't
We didn't get stopped because it was coming out of a very, you know, New York was still kind of bankruptcy. It was recovering from the bankruptcy crisis, so there weren't a lot of police. It was much more loose and wild. So we literally just drove around, found the lot, parked the van, filmed for 3 days. And, you know, lived in the van when we weren't, you know, filming in it. No one stopped us. In some ways, ignorance was bliss. Shot in 16mm, and I showed the film festival people the film in 16, and when they decided to put it into the festival, I met with a gentleman who's a French guy who liked the film, and he said, I'd like to put the film in the festival, but it has to be in 35mm, and I did not have any money. And he said, you know, I said, well, what does that mean? What's it going to cost to be in the festival? Because there are costs associated with a big festival. You need to blow up the print to 35mm, you need to get a publicist, you need you need to make a trailer, posters, you know, all that kind of stuff. And he said, it's going to cost about $25,000 to do all the things you need to do. And I was, you know, I went from being super excited to being a little, you know, kind of depressed because I didn't know how I was going to get that money. And again, so much of life is about luck and timing, it really is. Sitting literally at the table next to me, there were two people who overheard the conversation I was having with this man and said, do you mind if we interrupt? We happen to be film sales agents. if your film's going to be in the Cannes Film Festival, we will front you the money, at $25,000, to blow up the film and do all these things you need to do if you let us represent the film as the sales agents. And I said, sure. It was the Park and Meridian Hotel.
Go ahead. Oh, that she needed male sponsorship in order to survive.
Sponsor. She was, you know, but like a lot of hangers-on in that scene, you know, especially if you weren't as talented as some of the female singers like Blondie or Patti Smith, you know, the other way you became a part of that music scene was to be kind of a groupie, to latch on to somebody who wasn't a man. So, given that she really didn't have those kinds of artistic skills of her own, I think she felt she needed to latch onto something to survive, and well, to be a part of something.
Can I bring it back?
And knew so little about what the Cannes Film Festival was going to be like. I remember I turned up there with the lead actress, Susan Berman, and we were just astounded, you know, because the really, all the kind of cliches are true, you know, the paparazzi and just the crazy things that go on at the festival and the networking and the partying and all that. And we were like these, you know, two kids, you know, who just suddenly found ourselves there and, you know, kind of looked at it through rose-colored glasses. So it was surrealistic, is the best word. But it really was the thing that, you know, gave me, well, got me an agent, and after Cannes, the film was picked up in, you know, various territories around the world. So in that way, it enabled me to continue to make films. I don't remember what it was exactly. It's some documentary about disasters, but there are little weird clips. Again, being somebody who likes media and likes, you know, images within images, you know, TV shows, TV images within the frame, or movies within movies, I thought it was fun to kind of pepper the film with those kinds of references throughout, either using them in an ironic way or playful way, or as kind of commentary. I mean, I'm sure some of you might have seen, you know, the bedtime for Bonzo.
Yeah.
Obviously, this was during Reagan's presidency. And, you know, so just making those little layers of images appeal to me.
Well, thank you so much. This film, it looked great tonight. It'll look even better when you do this 35mm blow up, or in print. That'll be at the Metrograph.
In the summer.
It was great to see you again. Thanks so much for being here on behalf of the festival.
Thank you. Thank you.